Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, glory, all the honor. Thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in all of our hearts today. We thank you, Father, that we've come into the house of God, recognizing fully that the teacher of the church is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to do and be. And Father, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, as you not only bless us today, but you bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet. You bless our church, as well as the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis, Inland Christian Center. Thank you for all the great churches out there, our Catholic brothers and sisters as they proclaim Jesus, and our Adventist brothers and sisters as they proclaim Jesus. Lord, we're not the judge of anybody. We're just excited somebody's telling somebody about Jesus, and we ask you bless them as they do. In Jesus' mighty name. With a great big shout, come on everybody, with a great big shout, everybody say amen. Well, go ahead and take your seat and get your Bible out, because I'm gonna share some things with you that God shared with me today, and I think you're gonna like it. It's kind of fun to get to the word of the Lord. We've had a great time in the book, if you will, of Hebrews. I've never been in a church in my life that's taken as long as it is to teach the word of God line upon line, precept upon precept. In the book of Hebrews. Usually I talked to a guy the other day, he was a pastor, he says, yeah, last 2 weeks I've been in Hebrews, I've finished the book. And 2 weeks, how do you do that, man? It is like so full of information. We've been in it for years, I don't even know how many years. I would guess at least 3 years, and we're in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Why do we do this? Line upon line, precept upon precept. We do it because we're interested in you growing to maturity, get that. Maturity means you understand what's God and do God. Maturity means you know the difference between what is in the world and what isn't in the world, and you operate in the maturity level that God would have you to operate in. Therefore, you become the witness of the Lord Jesus Christ for the rest of your life. Until you get not just the word of God, but until you get the very character, nature, and attributes of God. Because I don't want to teach you the word of God without teaching you the very attributes of God. So that you can understand how it works, how it all fits together, how it all's developed. Go with me, if you will, into Hebrews, the 11th chapter. We're gonna continue our study in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, by taking a look at Abraham's life as we start to go. What's exciting about Hebrews in the 11th chapter is this is really the hall of faith or a hall of fame for God. These are people, men and women, who have so touched the heart of God that he made sure that their testimonies are held for thousands of years so you and I can look at their lives, grow by finding out what they did that was so impressive to God. And then we could change our lives by the power of the Holy Spirit. So here in the 11th chapter, as we look at, go to verse number 8, as we look at a man by the name of Abraham, and actually when this was written about him, his name was Abram. God hadn't changed his name yet. But it says these words, and I think they're really fascinating. Let's read them together. Verse number 8, it says, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place in which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. This is so bizarre. Before I give you the title of the message, let's talk about this just for a second. A lot of people think that Abraham went out because he was going to receive something from God. God told him to do it. You can see it right there. He's going to receive it as an inheritance. Therefore, he goes out. But a lot of people don't know this. Abraham was already rich. Abraham was in the land, if you will, of Ur. You'll find that Abraham was a moon worshiper. He worshiped the moon. His family had a heritage. He already had wealth, cattle, sheep, all the abundance of servants that you could possibly have, land and everything. The motive for him going out is because God spoke to him. And may I say this to you, listen closely to what I'm gonna say. A lot of people have different motives for why they do things, but when you hear the voice of the Lord and you are obedient to it, it changes everything. Here's this guy who had never heard from God before, and now he just knows that he knows that he knows that he knows. Just something like you, for an example. You know that you know that you know that you know. Nobody's going to talk you out of, there's God. You know that's on the depth of your heart on the inside. And you will find oftentimes people will make this mistake of not realizing who they really are. You see, you have to understand about the life of Abraham. Abraham was not the first Jew. Judah hadn't come into existence yet. Abraham was the first Hebrew that believed in God because he heard from God. And he did something that caught the attention of God. He did a lot of things, but this one thing that caught the attention of God, I highlighted up there, is that he obeyed God. You know, I found out a lot in life. I find out people who obey God are people who get blessed. People who do not obey God, even though they call themselves Christians, keep stumbling along, keep failing in life, keep being frustrated, keep falling and getting themselves up, dusting themselves off, but never really get anywhere because they have something that stops them from living the life that God would have them to live. And my time with people over the last 40 years of teaching the Word of God, I found out something simple. A lot of people do not want to obey God. I understand that. We live in an independent country. We live in a country that celebrates individuality, our own personal ideas and philosophies, and living by them. We're a people that gather together and say, we want to do things my way. In fact, I was at a funeral not too long ago, and this pastor was up in front giving a testimony about this man who had died as a young man. He was only 22 years old. And he said the one thing he could say about him that is really good is that he lived his life doing what he wanted to do, doing it his way. And I thought to myself, what a shame. He was killed in a motorcycle accident, in a motocross thing, and it shouldn't have been that way at all. He just wanted to do his thing, his way, and that was celebrated in our society as successful. May I say this to you? Nothing could be further from the truth than that. Even though we've all been taught that, all of us been encouraged to live our individual lives, until you get hooked up with God and find out it's not your desire but his that's important. It's not your plans but his that comes to pass. It's not your want, not your will, but it's his will and his want that's important in your life. Until you get to that place in your life, you will never be successful. Deborah and I, until we finally got to the place to be obedient with God's word. We knew God's word. We had heard God's word. We had sat in church for years. And guess what? We had celebrated. We raised our hands to God. We'd given our money. But until we decided to live obediently to what God says, even though most of the time what God was saying was abrasive to us, it was contrary to our thinking. It's not what we wanted. It's not what we saw. It's not what we had planned, but we decided to put all that aside and live for God and live God's way. It's then the thing started to turn around. It's then that Deborah and I became successful. It's then that God prospered our hands only with this word obedience. It's fascinating word. But I found out something also about people. If they understand why they should be obedient, it's a lot easier to be obedient. Let me say it again. If they understand why they should be obedient, then it's a lot easier to be obedient. Are you following me? Very important. And that's why the title of this message today is why, listen to these words, obey God. Because if you know something, I could probably give you 35 different things on reasons why to obey God, but I'm gonna give you three today that you can take with you and think about through all the whole entire week. Is that all right? Here's the three things that I think that you'll really like. I love this one. Number one, things to know about God, things to know about obedience, that why we should obey God. Here's number one. Father knows best. Can I finally get to the place in my life where I finally said, I don't know what the heck I'm doing? Everything I do seems up to be a mess. Everybody I follow seems to be a mess. Every decision I make is a mess. When you finally get to the place where you've tried it all, you've done everything you can to be successful and prosperous in your life, you finally get to the place where you realize, you know what? I don't know everything. I know that God cares about me and God loves me. He's got to care about me more than anything else. And if you're over 60 years old, there used to be a television show by the name of Father Knows Best. Anybody remember that? Don't raise your hand. That tells you how old you are. And you know, this was a father in a little white family, you know, he had a bunch of kids, and every time there was a problem, the father came in and solved the problem, and father was very respected. The movie was called, or the television show back in the 50s and 60s was called Father Knows Best. I found out something about God. He knows what's best for me. And he knows what's best for you. And I found out that he only wants us to obey, not because some egotist that he needs people to worship him, not because he's a control freak that tries to get you to do a bunch of stuff. He is a God that so cares about you and so cares about me. He knows that if I do what he wants me to do all through my life, I'm going to get blessed, and even my children's children are going to get blessed because God knows what's best for me. When I was a young man, a teenager, and you know how teenagers are. They can tell you they love you. They can tell you they care about you. There's two things that we all need to understand about teenagers. One, they love to sleep past the time they're supposed to. Two, they eat more than they should. And three, they don't think much of their parents when they're teenagers. And you know what I'm talking about because you probably have teenagers or you're one yourself. And during those periods of time, they're real rebellious. My father was a tough guy. Good guy, didn't know God. In fact, I led him to the Lord Jesus, but he knew God. He knew there was a God, but he didn't know anything about God, but he was a tough guy. He ran his house a certain way, and when he said something, that's the way it was. He'd say, don't hang around those guys. I don't like those guys. And I'd say, why? They're good guys. They haven't done anything wrong. He says, no, they're going to get in trouble, and you don't need to be around them. Don't hang around them. I'd rebel, you know, sneak out, go hang around them. Sure enough, we'd all get in trouble, and Dad would come and slap me upside the head, talk to me about things his way, which was the rod. And I want you to know something. I learned to respect my father that way. When I got older, I realized that my dad just loved me. He used to spank me and say, this is going to hurt more me than it is you. I never believed that until I had my own kids. It's so true. Today, my father's a long time gone on to be with the Lord, but I can say this to you. Thank God there was a father in the house that loved me enough to care for me, not let me play in the street when there's a truck coming, that cared for my well-being and my best in life. Some of you may not have had a father in your life, may not have had somebody who cared about you or loved you or guided you. Nobody was there for you. Maybe you don't understand about that father relationship. Here's what I've got to say to you. Get over it. You have a new father. He's in the heavens and he loves you more than the earthly father will ever love you. And may I say this to you? Listen to what I'm going to say. And with him, the playing field is always level. So what you have missed out on doesn't have to stop from the benefits. Don't let your past control your future. Your future's in your father's hands who knows best. Is anybody listening today? When you finally get to that place where you realize that you're not as smart as God, you laugh, but you can't believe how many people make decisions on their own, do their own thing, want God to get involved in it, never check with God. Never communicate with God. Just hope God goes along with them. But I want you to know something. You're on the wrong road. You need to check with God. God will tell you. God will advise you. God will give you wisdom. You know why? Because he loves you more than you even know. He knows more about you than you know about yourself. Can I say something about this also? Think about this. Your father is the smartest there ever was on this planet and ever will be on this planet. He speaks and planets exist Are you kidding me? He walks on water. He raises the dead. He opens the blind's eyes. I don't know about your earthly father. I don't think he did that. Guess what? He's a whole lot smarter than you will ever be. So you ought to be a person who's obedient because he's got your best interest at hand. Come on, somebody. Now, in the book of Deuteronomy, go with me to Deuteronomy real quick in the Old Testament. Let's go back to the book of Deuteronomy. You're going to love this. In Deuteronomy, the fifth chapter, and in verse number 29, the fifth chapter of Deuteronomy, you see this passion of God coming out. This is God speaking in Deuteronomy 5:29. And it's so interesting. The very first word that comes up is this word, oh. God is speaking, oh. It's almost like a groan from inside of his heart towards you and towards me. It's almost like this bit of passion that comes out. When I heard that Deborah landed at LAX and she's coming home, I got so excited. I went, oh. And can I just say this to you? Listen to this. Here's God speaking this about you. Oh, that they had such a heart in them. Stop right there. Look back up at me. Obedience doesn't come out of following rules and regulations. That's religion. You can't do this. You can't do that. You shouldn't do that. You shouldn't do this. That's religion. Obedience comes out of the heart. And when it comes from the heart because you love him and know he's got your best interest at hand and you want to please him with everything you do, all of a sudden, obedience takes a new form and it catches the eye and the heart of God. So God makes this statement, oh, not that they would just do what I tell them to do. Oh, no. Oh, that they would have a what? Heart. Watch this. In them, that they would fear me. See the words fear me up there? Fear is an interesting word. He's talking about a two-sided coin. On one side, it's fear, like I'm afraid of God. Don't mess with God. God's going to get you, man. And trust me, may I say this to you? Don't mess with God. You ought to have a fear of God. Don't play games with him. Now, listen to this. But the other side of the coin is respect and reverence. Like, oh, my goodness, I'm in awe of his greatness. So he says that they would have a heart to so fear me that we would do something. Watch this. And always keep my commandments that it might be well with them, that it might be well with them, that it might be well with them, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. Did you know when you're obedient to God from your heart that it not only affects you, but affects your heritage and your children's children forever? Oh my goodness sakes alive. That means you can break those family curses right there in a second. All those things, those generational things of the past, no longer does it have to happen. All you need to do is a person that realizes God is smarter than me and he has my best interest in hand and I will obey what he says, even though it strains me at times. It puts pressure on me, which brings us to number two. And I love number two. If you'll read it with me, this is what you should know about obedience. Listen closely. Things to know. Number two, true worship is obedience. And I don't mean that it's the only way of worship. True worship, I should even say on this way, best worship is obedience. A lot of people don't understand that. We've been trained in American churches to sing songs. You talk to people, they say, oh yeah, I'm in my church and I'm a song leader in my church and I lead worship in my church. And that's great. Don't misunderstand me. We need to do that. There's many times when we connect with God in what we call a song service or a worship service part of the service, you know, where we connect with God, we're touched by God, the tears run down our face because we're so connected with God. And, you know, I'm excited about that. And I think that's wonderful. But I don't want to stop at a song. I don't want to stop at a beat. I don't want to rely on a music sound to bring my heart before God. So the better, our best worship to God is when I hear what he has for me to do, and it may rub me the wrong way, but I do it anyway. That, my friends, is the best worship to God. Come on, somebody. Now, in order to show that to you, I'm going to take you back to Genesis in the 22nd chapter. So go there with me in Genesis 22nd chapter. Talk about Abraham. Let's talk about Abraham a little bit. And here we find that Abraham is doing something interesting. Let me set you up for this story so you can follow the story. Get this picture. It's kind of cool. Abraham is without a child, doesn't have his own child, has a lot of money, has a lot of blessings, has a lot of stock and, you know, sheep and goats and a lot of people working for him, servants, has everything God promised. He has an abundance of everything, huh? And except he doesn't have a child, which is very difficult in those days because all of that abundance goes to the firstborn male. All the blessings goes to the firstborn. He didn't even have firstborn male, didn't have anything. And now they're gotten up in years. His wife's name is Sarah. She's 90. He's 100 years old. And God calls them together and speaks to them. And he tells Sarah, you're going to have a child, you know, and she has a hard time buying that one. And he is close to 100 years old. And he says, you know, we're going to give Sarah, get her pregnant, and she's going to have a son, you know, and he's like exuberant. I want you to know that in itself is a miracle. You could stop right there and never say anything else. As far as I'm concerned, if Deborah came back from Israel and she was pregnant, I'd shoot myself. I wouldn't be excited about it at all. You know what I'm saying? Get up, honey. It's your turn to change the diapers. I did that. I don't even like the grandkids over when they got diapers on, let alone my own. You know, does anybody know what I'm talking about? And so he's 100 years old, and he's elated because he doesn't have a child. So all of a sudden, he has this child. His name is Isaac, and oh, man, he is, like, thrilled. He is so madly in love and proud of Isaac. My friends, listen to me. It's the most important thing in his life, more important than his sheep, more important than his goats, more important than anything else. It's everything. Now he fulfills the promise of God, and when he dies, he passes it all on to Isaac. He's probably proud like most dads, busting buttons, caring about Isaac, doing all those things that you do for a son you're in love with. And God speaks to him. And God says, I want you to take Isaac. I'll show you where to offer him. Offer him up as a burnt offering to me. Oh, my goodness. You don't know what that means. But let me tell you what a burnt offering is. That means you start a big fire and you take your sheep or your goat. In this case, it's going to be his son Isaac. Put it on the fire and burn him to ashes that there's nothing left of him. Oh, my goodness. The one he loves, the one he's proud of. Now, keep in mind, he doesn't know this God very well. He's just obedient to God. He doesn't have a Bible in his lap like you. He doesn't have thousands of years of examples before him that he could follow. He doesn't know that this God does not accept human sacrifice. It's an abomination to our God. He doesn't know that. And yet, he's going to follow. Let's pick it up, if you will, in Genesis 22nd chapter. I'll read to you out of verse number 1. And it came to pass that after these things, that God, and I love this next word, tested Abraham, tested. You and I will be tested with the things that we love. God will just test us to see if we'll be obedient. And I don't know about you, but I want to pass the test. I don't want to love anything more. I don't want to put any more value on anything except my God. My God I love the most. My God is the most valuable. And with Abraham, that's exactly the test he had to follow. Is it going to be Isaac, your son, or is it going to be the word of God? Man, none of us have ever been in a position like this, but this Abraham is going to follow through. Verse number 2. Then he said, take now your son, this is God speaking to Abraham, your only son Isaac, in whom you love. and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains in which I should tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son, and he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and he went to a place which God had told him. Verse 4. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw a place far off. And Abraham said to his young men that were with him, now watch this, stay here with the donkey. The lad and I are going to go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. True worship, the best worship, is connected with obedience. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. There is a law of study in the Word of God. It's called the law of first use. If you're a theologian, you understand what I'm talking about. The first time a word is used in the Bible is, now not always, but usually that is the description and that is the passage that carries the meaning of that word through the rest of the Bible. It's called the law of first use. The first time the word worship is ever spoken in the Bible is right here. Go yonder and worship. And it's connected with obedience. Someone might say to me, well, Pastor, maybe it's connected with the sacrifice that he was going to offer. Uh-uh. And how I know that is because of 1 Samuel, the 15th chapter, probably verse number 22, where Samuel, the great prophet, is talking to King Saul, who had failed miserably before God. And King Saul is so frustrated, he's offering these burnt offerings and these offerings and these sacrifices before God. When Samuel walks in and sees King Saul doing that, he gets all angry and ticked off. And in verse number 22, he says, what, you think that sacrifice is better than obedience? God doesn't want sacrifice. He wants obedience more than sacrifice. See, sometimes we'll sacrifice, but we won't be obedient. Let's take it down to our level. Some of you might have said to yourself, I'll go to church today with you. I'll give up my time in the sun. I'll give up playing ball. I could have gone to the beach. And I'll go to church. And you think that sacrifice is doing something before God, when in fact the purpose of going to church is so you can learn about God on what's right and wrong. It's not about sacrifice as much as it is about obedience. And a lot of times we'll come and we'll sacrifice our time and we'll sacrifice our $5 and we'll sacrifice our own lifestyle when in fact God wants us not for the little sacrifice we're offering on a Sunday, but it'll be obedient to his word, because with a heart of obedience gets the attention and the blessings of God. And true best worship comes when I'm obedient to God, even in things that are frustrating to me. Don't you think it was frustrating to Abraham? Don't you think he was challenged? Oh my goodness, who spoke that? Was that you, God? You want me to offer my son up? What is this all about? This is crazy. I'm in love with him. He's my whole life. He's my inheritance. Oh my goodness, this is what you promised me. Now I've got to put him on the altar. And if you know the story, he goes so far to tie his son up. Can you imagine his teenage son looking at his dad saying, Dad, what are you doing? He puts him on the wood. He's going to lift a knife to him and kill him and then burn him as a burnt offering. When God speaks and says, Abraham, don't do that. I'll supply you a ram. And a ram that was caught in some thicket right there. He went and got the ram, cut his son loose, and offered that as a sacrifice. It's the first time in the Bible where you see God provision along with obedience. God provided the ram for the sacrifice, where he's called Jehovah Jireh. It's the first time ever. Now, may I say this to you? Along with obedience is worship. Along with obedience is the blessings or the provisions of God, which brings us to number three today. Things you need to know about obedience. Number three, I love this. Obedience brings blessings into your life. Isn't that weird? I thought hard work. Well, yeah, sure, you can't sit back, do nothing, expect to get blessed. I thought, singing songs. I thought, putting a cross around my neck would bring blessings. I thought, you know, driving a car with a bumper sticker on it will bring me blessings. Can I tell you something? Get out of that stupid Christianity. That stupid Christianity been taught for 250 years the wrong thing about the way we have a relationship with God. And here's a relationship with God. Out of my heart, I want to serve God because he's smarter than me and has my best interest. Number two, when I serve God, man, that's real worship and it catches the heart of God. But number three, by obedience, because it comes from my heart, guess what happens? Brings blessings into my life. Until then, not gonna get the blessings. There's this guy named Moses, you know that. He's leading the children of Israel out of Egypt into the promised land, never gets there. Nope, sadly to say, never got there. Because the entire generation that he's leading is doubting God. They're not obedient to God at all. The entire generation had to die and their kids had to come up in order to be obedient. And when they came up, now they're ready to go into the promised land because God spoke, this is yours. In other words, God wants to give you your own personal promised land, but it's gonna come through obedience. It's not gonna come by doing it your own way. And a guy by the name of Joshua is leading this new generation of people into the promised land because they know how to obey God. And God makes this statement in Joshua 1 and 8, right off the first bat, first chapter of Joshua, as he's telling Joshua what to do. In verse number 8, he says, this book of the law, it's all they had in those days. We have a whole lot more today. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate it day and night. I don't know about you, but he's talking about this word of God, the things that God says that you're to be obedient. Can I ask you a question? If you don't know what to be obedient to, how can you be obedient to it? If you don't know how to be obedient, how can you be obedient? You will follow your flesh forever. You will follow the politicians forever. You will follow CNN. You will follow Fox. You will follow the Republicans. You will follow the Democrats. You will follow the independents, when in fact you should be a pedestrian and follow God. Come on, somebody. And he comes and he says, meditate it day and night. In other words, you're holding it somewhere inside of your heart, that you may observe and do according that is written in it. May I observe, because I know what it's all about, and do according to what God says. When you have to deal with your husband, here's how God says to deal with it. When you have to deal with your wife, here's how God says to deal with it. When you have to deal with those teenage kids, here's how God says to do it. Here's what God says on how you deal with your boss. Here's how God says to make an investment. Here's how God says to deal with prosperity. Here's what God says about this. When you understand all of this, may I say this to you, then you can be obedient to it. Until you understand it, you will never be obedient. You will just sit in church year after year, never change. And you wonder why? It's because you haven't gotten to the place in your life of number one, realizing that God knows best. Number two, you haven't gotten into real worship by following God with obedience. And number three, realizing that your prosperity is going to come as you do and be obedient to the word of God. That's the first part of Joshua 1:8. But I like the last part of Joshua 1:8. Flip it up for me. For then, after you've meditated, after you thought about it day and night, after you know what to do, after you're doing it because you got a heart to do it, not some religious guy telling you to do it, but you have a heart to do it, it's coming from the inside of you. And then you will make your way prosperous. And then, not before, and then you will have good success. I don't know about you, but I want good success. I want to be prosperous. Now look, let's talk just for a moment. I'm not bragging to you. I'm just telling you the truth. I've been doing this for 50 years, 40 years as a senior pastor. Most of you aren't even that old. Let's talk. Grandpa needs to tell you the truth. You never had a grandpa ever tell you the truth. If you're going to live your life, live it for Jesus. Find out what the heck that word has to say, even though it doesn't fit with your feelings, even doesn't fit with your thinking, even though it doesn't fit with your plans. Man, I remember when we started this church, Debbie would cry all the time. I said, why are you crying? She said, oh, there's such a presence of God. I started crying too, but I was crying because I had to do it. I didn't want to be a pastor. But I had to be obedient. I had different plans. Who wants to be a pastor? You got to be kidding me. Meet people at the back door, tell you all kinds of crazy things. Hello, good to see you today, Pastor. Shut up. I can hardly wait to slap you. I put up 40 years of that stuff. And then God says, you got to love them and stop talking that way and thinking that. And I said, okay, I got to be obedient to it. The point being is this, good success. All my kids serving God. Got 12 grandkids. They all want to be pastors. What's that all about? They all preach in a mirror. The little guys like this preaching in mirrors, singing songs. My wife's nuts about me. Grandpa loves grandma. Grandma loves grandpa. There's no fighting going on. There's nothing going on. Well, there's something going on, but not as often as usual. You know what I'm talking about, huh? To the pure, all things are pure. You're bad. And so I want you to know I'm still in love. My kids are in love. My kids are serving God. My kids are preaching the gospel all over the place. What from? Because living testimonies, obedience to God. Guys, it's what you need from your heart. This will take you to levels you've never, ever dreamt of. And I believe next week's even going to get better. If you got something from God, give the Lord a great big praise. Hey, I just want to do this. Could I just pop up John, the 14th chapter, verse 23? Here's Jesus, New Testament. If anyone loves me, I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I do my own thing, but I love you, Jesus. I love you. I want you to get involved in what I'm doing. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. He says, if anybody loves me, I will get involved with you and do everything you want me to do, Jesus says. Is that what your Bible says? No. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And the Father will come make a new home. You want a new home, a new life, new family? Guess what? That's what you need. It's right here. If you love him, you'll keep his word. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Isn't that good? Woo! I just want to make sure everybody's all right with God, and then I'll let you go. Is that all right? So just for a moment, give me your attention. You've done such a good job of giving me your attention through this whole day. You're amazing. You're just like the best of all the services today. Thank you for being kind. But let's talk just for a moment. Some of you in here, are going to die and go to hell unless somebody respects you enough, honors you enough to stop playing church and tell you the truth. I respect and honor you enough to tell you the truth. If you'd like to check out where you're at with God, I'm going to ask you a question. I want you to answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Is that all right? Now, people behind you won't know. People next to you won't know. Nobody will know but you and God. And your answer will define where you're really at with God, whether you're going to heaven or whether you're going to go to hell. I'm going to ask you this question. If you were to walk out of this building, head towards your car, and your heart stopped and you died, bang! Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? There's only two things in the Bible that are eternal, man's soul and the Word of God. Only two things, really fascinating. The Word of God is eternal and the soul of man. You will live one where, one place or the other. And that's totally your call. No one else's. Some of you may have answered, well, I think I'm going to go to heaven, Pastor Jim. I think I'm going to make it. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say if you're a positive thinker, you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it, and somebody should tell you. It's not in the Bible. Some of you answered, well, I hope that if I died, I'd go to hell. Go to heaven, not go to hell. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you can hope your way into heaven and out of hell. Nowhere does it say that the greater hoper gets to go to heaven. There's no such thing. You're not going to make it. Some of you said to yourself, well, I'm really a good person, Pastor Jim. You know, I'm really good, and I was told all my life that if I'm good, I'll get to heaven. Can I tell you something? That's total foolishness. It's not in the Bible. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you're good. Did you know that most people that attend American churches think they're going to heaven because they're good? But nowhere in the Bible does it say that. You're not going to make it, and somebody needs to love you and respect you and tell you enough. To tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. And some of you might have said, well, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, I've always thought of myself as a Christian. My mom and dad told me I was a Christian. They took me to catechism class or Sunday school or Sabbath school class when I was a child. I've always thought of myself, I wore a cross or St. Christopher around my neck. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible does it say your mom and dad put religious jewelry on you, take you to religious classes, and that makes you a Christian. It's not in the Bible. Some of you said, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, I joined my last church. I was there for years. I sang in the choir. I helped the pastor. I carried the offering. I counseled people in that church. I was considered a leader in the church. Does it say anything in the Bible that you, because you sang in the choir, helped the pastor, carried his Bible, counted the offering, was a leader, you get to go to heaven? It's not in the Bible at all. You're not going to make it, and somebody needs to tell you. I know that's shocking. Jesus makes this comment, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That's a bizarre statement. You can't make it any other way. You can't make it your way. You can't make it my way. You can't make it some well-meaning church committee's way. You got to make it His way. And He tells us exactly His way in the Scripture. He died for you on that cross? Yes. But do you think He wouldn't tell you what that means and how to get associated with Him? He says this in John, the third chapter. You must be born again. In America, when I use the words born again, everybody freaks out because the movies have brainwashed us and television have brainwashed us that born again people are idiots and fanatics and religious jerkballs. But I'm here to tell you that's not what Jesus talked about when He used the word born again. If He said you must be born again, then you must. But let's define for you exactly what born again really means. Are you ready? Here's what it means. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it means that God is after all of your heart and God is after all of your life, and you have to give Him all of your heart and all of your life. You got to give it because He's not a thief to rob it from you. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it. He's not a manipulator to make you do it. It's your free will call to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. Without it, it doesn't work. I'll prove it to you that it's all or nothing. Can I prove it to you? I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. You've heard about it, the book of Revelation. Jesus Himself is speaking in the book of Revelation. He says, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot, or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness. Jesus, nice, kind, wonderful, smiling, gracious Jesus, said He'll vomit me from His mouth? What He's saying is, I will reject you if you're lukewarm. Let's define lukewarm. Lukewarm is somebody who's a little in and a little out. Lukewarm is a little up and a little down. Lukewarm is, you know, you're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. God is just something in your life, but He's not everything in your life. You don't mind going to church once in a while, as long as you don't overdo it. You don't mind praying once in a while, but you never stick to anything seriously. You just throw up token prayers most of the time when you're in trouble. That's lukewarm. Today, you can change that. If God said I need to be born again, I need to be obedient to what He wants, not what I feel or what I think. And you today, in this safe and friendly place, you can give God all of your heart. You can give God all of your life. Today is your divine appointment with God. God calling you home. You've had a lot of appointments in your life. Doctors, attorneys, dentists, plumbers. But today you have one. God brought you here to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. Today is your day of salvation. And you need to obey and give God what He wants and what He paid for on that cross, a beaten bloody mess. He paid for all of your life and prayed for all of your heart. You say, Pastor Jim, how do I do that? Well, let's give God the right way of doing it. Jesus said it like this: if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this: one, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! Your hand goes up, and I'll see your hand go up, and you can put it right back down after I see it. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I don't want Jesus in my head like most Americans. You know, I know you celebrate Christmas, and I know you celebrate Easter. But you can do that with Jesus in your head, but that won't get you to heaven. Even the devil knows who Jesus is in his head. This is about giving God all of your heart, giving God all of your life. Today is your day of salvation. Who should raise your hand when you hear this? Bang! Your hand should go up if you've been running from God instead of to God. If you've never given him all of your heart, get ready to put your hand up. If you're one of those people that have never given him all of your life, get ready to put your hand up. If you just know who he is in your head, but you haven't given him all of your heart, today is your day of salvation. If you're just in that place where you don't know for sure if this is what you need to do, make sure and do it. Maybe you prayed with Billy Graham on television. Maybe you prayed at a Harvest Crusade. But did you follow up with all of your heart? Listen to me now. Did you follow up with all of your life? Or was that just a magical abracadabra formula of words that you repeated after someone else and you went on living your own life? God's not stupid. Don't think he's in the heavens saying, well, I heard the right formula of words. It's called a prayer. I guess I'll come into their life. He watches your heart and your life to see whether or not you're faithful. Today is your day. Some of you need to make a recommitment. Some of you need to get back to God. Some of you have never given him a wholehearted commitment. Today is your day of salvation, giving him everything. I'm counting to three. I'm popping my hands together. I've done my job before you and before God, and I've loved you and respect you enough to tell you the truth and not play games. It's your call. Sit there and do nothing, or get your hand up and get right with God and be obedient to the things of the Lord. Today is your day. I'm counting to three. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, thank you, three, thank you. Back here, there's four, thank you. There's five, six up on top, back over here, thank you. There's seven back here, thank you. There's eight back here, thank you. In the family room, is there anybody? Thank you. There's eight wise people already. Anybody else, real quick? I think I already got them back there. I think I already got them. Anybody else, real quick? You need to give God all of your heart. There's nine. Come on, somebody realize I'm not embarrassing them. I won't embarrass you. Why would you sit there and stare at me when you know you need to get your hand up? There's 10. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? There's 11. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on. There's about 10 wise people. Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. Thank you for being obedient. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend. If you raised your hand with God, I want you to get your stuff together. I want you to get a friend. If you need a friend, I want you to get in the aisle, meet me in front, and then I'll let you go. But listen closely. Listen, if you can't walk an aisle for Jesus Christ in a safe and friendly place, how will you ever live with for him outside in a vicious, mean world? I want all of us in a moment to stand. Anybody that raised their hand and you're serious about God, I want you to come forward, bring your stuff. Anybody that should have raised their hand but you didn't you know you should have, get a hold of your stuff, get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. Let's hurry because I want to dismiss the people. I want you to come right now. Let's stand and welcome them. Nobody leave during this period of time. You come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
To Jesus.
Thank you for coming. Come on. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Come on, you come too. Come on. You know you need to. Come on, come on. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise for these people. People are still coming. Give them a hand.
He will save.
Yeah, come on. Thanks for coming.
He will save.
Thanks for coming. God bless you. Isn't God good? They're still coming. Give them a hand. They're still coming. Give them a hand. God good. A whole lot more than 10 of you. Oh my goodness, they're still coming. Give them a hand. Come on, you come too. Come on. Come on home. Come on home. Thank you for coming. Woo! The Bible says, oh, they're still coming. Come on. Come on, we'll wait for you. We'll wait for you. Come on. The Bible says no one comes to the Lord except by the Holy Spirit. You just saw a great move of the Holy Spirit right before your eyes. Thank you for coming, all of you. I want you to look over here. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. He's a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on, I promise you. You can put a smile on your face. He's going to do three things. He's going to pray with you. You need to invite Jesus into your heart. Jesus does not come into your heart because you came forward or raised your hand. He comes into your heart because you invite him to come in. He's a gentleman, so he'll lead you in a prayer to invite him in. Secondly, he'll give you a little booklet about what to do next. I mean, now that you're saved, what does God expect? Then he's going to tell you this little booklet to get back to church and how important it is for you to get back. And thirdly, he's going to introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. You heard of personal trainers? Like in a gymnasium, that personal trainer gets you all buffed out looking like me. What are you laughing at? And so get you all buffed out. That's a personal trainer. Well, this is a spiritual personal trainer. You'll meet him before church service. He'll buy you coffee, tea, nachos, lobster, steak, whatever it takes to get you back to church, you know? And then they'll go over some scripture with you. Really fun people. They'll pray for you during the week. You need somebody to help you keep going on. In other words, the devil will rope you and rip you right back into the world. Let us help you go forward, okay? After four or five times of meeting them, you're going to be solid and healthy and strong. We're excited about you coming. Could you all just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right over this way? Come on, let's give them a great big praise. Thank you, Lord.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.